All right, great. Well, thank you all for sticking it out to the end here this evening. Wish we could have a chance to meet in person, but maybe next year. So this is going to be a bit of a different talk than I generally share. I generally like to have a lot of Delaware specific insect pest management data and then kind of relate that to the broader picture. But to be honest, I haven't done nearly as much with fruit crops. However, fruit is really fun. When I moved to Delaware, I started planting my yard up with all sorts of fruit bearing plants and trees with the goal of being able to make a pie whenever I want between April and December, part of the way there. And so I've run into a few of the kind of the common nemesis that many of y'all struggle with as well. Fruit crops also have a fairly unique alphabet soup of insect pests that all need management. Let's see here. Let me hit the, oops. Apparently I hit the wrong part of that screen and almost sent myself an email. Okay, there we go. This here is a picture of my first apple yield. I think I missed a spray here. There's a lot of different things going on in this on these apples. We'll touch on at least one of them. The biggest pest of small fruits is this little guy. He will quickly decimate a strawberry or a blackberry yield. But the next biggest for small fruit is probably this one, the spotted wing Drosophila. Kathy already touched on, this is one of the most important pests in small fruit, certainly for cane bearers, blackberries, raspberries. It's also can be a significant pest for blueberries. Strawberries are one of its most favored hosts, right between the raspberries and blackberries. But fortunately for us, we typically don't catch this one in our traps until late May, early June. We use traps baited with apple cider vinegar with yellow sticky cards. This graph here is from Hannah Burak with NC State. She's their small fruit and tobacco extension entomologist. And her traps show the same thing. They don't start picking up spotted wing Drosophila till really the end of June or so. So a lot of the strawberries escape spotted wing pressure. But day neutral varieties or late varieties could still see damage from this pest. In my home garden, I've got a day neutral variety and it got whacked by our mid-April freeze. As you can see from this flower here with the dead center. Fortunately they reflowered and I still was able to make a strawberry rhubarb pie out of my garden, but those berries came in several weeks later. And that would be a classic scenario in which spotted wing could cause issues in the strawberries. They are also significant pests of blueberries, especially like mid to late season blueberries, and definitely on caneberries. There's a couple of ways we can monitor for spotted wing Drosophila in the fruit. I told you about trapping for adults with the apple cider vinegar. In the fruit, a lot of folks will do either a sugar or a salt float test. You basically put the harvested fruit in a bag and you mash it up in a solution of sugary water or salty water. And the larvae will come out of that fruit and float to the top. And you can use that to get an idea of one, how much fruit has an infestation during that current picking cycle, but also to assess the results of a spray program. The other thing that you may notice with infested fruit is fruit bleeding. This here is a blackberry in the center left. This little red drupelet here in the center, it's got a really tiny puncture hole. And if you just apply a very gentle pressure to that berry, it will ooze out fluid. There is a maggot developing in that drupelet. And if you got like a white paper towel or something on the bottom of a picking bucket or a basket, if you start seeing juice on that paper towel, that's a good indicator that there are potential for maggots in that fruit. So unfortunately with this pest, our most effective chemicals are also our some of our hardest hitting. The pyrethroids generally are excellent for controlling spotted wing Drosophila. There's some minor differences among them. Among the carbamates, lanate is very effective, but it has no residual activity and it's really toxic for handlers. Our organophosphates, some fruits we still have imidan labeled, some fruits we've got malathion as an option. But then in kind of our more IPM friendly choices, we do have diamides and spinosins. The diamides include Exoril, which is cyantraniliprole, and a fairly new product that came on the market a couple of years ago, Vertiprin. This is cyclaniliprole. It's a little bit broader spectrum of activity. In the spinosin class, we've got spinetoram, which is Entrust, and that's also probably the most effective organic material available for spotted wing Drosophila control. And then we've got Entrust is spinosad. Spinetoram is Radiant and Delegate. And those are not OMRI approved. They're synthetic. I want to make a couple of comments regarding these individual chemistries. First, check your pre-harvest intervals. They are not the same from one small fruit category to another for the same product. For instance, Exoril has a 3-day pre-harvest interval on bush berries, but a 1-day pre-harvest interval on cane berries and strawberries. Vertiprin, in the same class as Exoril, has a 1-day pre-harvest interval for all small fruit. Also, double check to make sure that the product that you're using is labeled for the crop. For instance, Imidan is only labeled for blueberries and cherries. Malathion in Delaware, we've got a 24C for blueberry growers to use Gowan's Malathion 8F, and it's got a 3-day pre-harvest interval. So there's a couple of things that you do want to keep in mind. Entrust has a 2EE recommendation for using 2 fluid ounces instead of the 4-6 fluid ounce rate. And that's really important because that gives us the opportunity to apply more applications of Entrust before we hit the maximum use rate per season. The current recommendations are to hit spotted wing Drosophila really hard early and then come back with the kind of the softer chemistries. And that seems to really help keep them out of the planting, kind of cleans them up a little bit. Also, a couple of these products do have curative action, meaning that if you spray spinetoram, which is Radiant or Delegate, or Imidan, those products will kill the eggs that have been laid inside that ripening fruit. A sale on this graph is a neonic, and it ranks as a kind of fair product here for adult control, but it has a pretty high curative activity. And the diamides also have some curative activity. So we do not want to rely solely on insecticides. One, if we've got a very diverse planting, it's very easy to mix up which planting has a 1-day pre-harvest interval versus a 3, or how many times that product has been applied, especially if you have a very long season. So we need other management strategies to reduce the overall pressure coming in. There is risk for resistance in this pest. California is starting to lose Entrust efficacy. So we want to make sure that we keep all of our options available. So as Kathy mentioned in her presentation, spotted wing Drosophila really likes cool, humid environments. Reducing overhead watering and moderate pruning will help air open the canopy, reduce the humidity in the interior of that canopy. It also allows for better insecticide penetration in the canopy. When spotted wing Drosophila finishes developing in the fruit, the maggot will drop out of the fruit and pupate in the ground. So using weed fabric or mylar mulch will help interfere with its ability to successfully pupate. In commercial plantings where spotted wing Drosophila is well managed, most of those eggs are laid in the ripe fruit. And this is really important because if we remove that ripe fruit frequently, it reduces the overall attractiveness of that planting. So harvesting frequently every 2 days results in the highest marketable yield per time investment, as opposed to harvesting every day and harvesting every 3 days. Again, watch out for your pre-harvest intervals. A lot of products have a 3-day pre-harvest interval. And then if you have culls, bag them up, leave them in a nice tied bag in the sun, basically bakes those maggots. Kathy also mentioned exclusion netting and refrigeration. Berries that are held between 32 and 36 degrees will stop development of the maggots and will kill eggs and small larvae. So next I'm gonna move into a couple of other pests for strawberries specifically. The first one is tarnished plant bug. This one, we had a real plague of them at Carville this year. Gordon mentioned that, as did Adam. This is a very small, mottled brown insect with piercing, sucking mouth parts. The nymphs are small and green. Here's a fairly large late stage nymph in the bottom left picture here. But in the bottom right, this little green blob right there, right next to the flower that has the petals that have fallen off, that is a tarnished plant bug nymph as well. And what these things do is that when they feed, they basically kill that little portion of the developing fruit, and then the rest of the fruit grows in around it. And you get this, what we call cat facing. Little bit of a trivia here. I don't know if anyone of y'all sees this russeting on strawberries. I've circled this patch right here in yellow. This is not caused by tarnished plant bug. This is actually caused by thrips. Thrips are a very unusual and kind of a trivia issue in strawberries. The threshold for thrips is really high. North Carolina, Dr. Burak does not consider them to be much of an economic threat. They may build up in late plantings or varieties that flower late. So that was just a little bit of trivia that I noticed when I was going through both some extension literature and some old photos. So for tarnished plant bug, the threshold is 1 nymph per 4 trusses right before bloom. And if you do have them, we've got several options. Many of these are also very good against spotted wing Drosophila and sap beetles, including malathion and our pyrethroids. Watch out for the pre-harvest intervals again. Some of these have pretty long pre-harvest intervals. So if you have multiple plantings side by side, that could be an issue, or multiple varieties rather. These products here are also pretty hard on bees, except for Belief. I don't know if any of y'all have any cotton growing experience, but Belief is also labeled in cotton for tarnished plant bug under the trade name Carbine. It's a very good product, but it's also very specific. It pretty much only gets tarnished plant bug. It will get thrips and some of the other sucking bugs. Moving on, we also ran into a 2-spot spider mite in our strawberries this year at Carville. Threshold for spider mites is 5 mites per leaflet prior to fruiting. Last year now, we had a very warm winter, And I think we also had some infested transplants. So the combination of infested transplants with a mild winter led to early season mite populations just taking off. Once the plants begin fruiting, the threshold is much higher, around 20 mites per leaflet. Adam mentioned that out in California, they use a lot of persimilis. And Kathy mentioned a couple of other predatory mite species that can be used to combat two-spot spider mite. California recommends using them around 1.5 to 5 predators per plant. With predatory mites, if you do use them, you need to put them out much earlier than the threshold for a conventional insecticide or miticide application. And that's because it takes those mites a couple of weeks to get their populations established before they start exerting control of two-spot spider mite. We did monitor spider mite populations in the strawberries at Carville that were getting treated with the UVC robot. This here is a graph of the cumulative mite days at Carville. UVC here is in the blue, and our untreated check is in the orange. So it pretty consistently kept those spider mite populations a little bit lower than had it not run over those plants. And Adam shared some of the hiccups that we had at Carville with that robot. So this is technology that does have quite a bit of potential for providing some good control. I do not have a graph of predatory mites on this in this presentation, but we do have predatory mite data. We had some Neocelis phalaensis mites show up in the strawberry planting, and the UVC robot did not seem to have a significant impact on our predators, which was pretty interesting. A couple of other berry bad problems. D-shaped fruit. That's a combination of misshapen and deformed. This D-shaped fruit here is not caused by tarnished plant bug. This was caused by poor pollination. If you see these little seeds here, those are about half the size. They're not developed compared to the mature seeds here on the shoulder of the fruit. That is classic with pollination and cold injury. Whereas our tarnished plant bugs, those seeds are going to be the same size are all throughout the kind of the crinkled area. This here strawberry in the center, that's got a crater in it. That can be caused either by sap beetles or by slugs. In this case, it was caused by a slug. This, you can still sort of see the slime trail left by the slug. And this spring, we had tremendous slug pressure. Very conducive weather for slugs with the temperatures cooling down in April and May and being pretty cloudy. This is something that you're more likely going to see in matted row systems as opposed to black plastic. And the only products that we have for combating slugs are slug baits such as Deadline or iron phosphate baits. Some of those are OMRI approved. And then for anyone growing raspberries and blackberries, Jerry Brust had an article about this pest right here in the weekly crop update from June 12. This has caused this crinkling and kind of leaf scorching is being caused by broad mites. This is a growing problem in the South. We don't have as much experience with it up here in the Mid-Atlantic, but they are spreading. They're very small mites. You need a very high magnification to see them. And Jerry wrote that the damage was first evident at the end of May. So be scouting your cane-bearing fruits for these leaf distortions. All right, I'm going to transition now to another pest of fruit. Let's see here. And this is the plum curculio. There we go. This is a major pest of stone fruit, pom fruits, and early and mid-season blueberries here in the Mid-Atlantic. And it, even though it does have preferences among the different fruit crops, it will pretty much attack them all. They've got numerous wild hosts. They come into orchards from the outside of the orchard, and they will cause scarring on the fruit and also fruit drop. It's a fairly small beetle, about yay big. It likes to play dead when it's disturbed. It comes in right around petal fall. So in some of the older literature, they suggested, 3 to 4 days in the 60s, couple of days in the 70s after petal fall, or right around 196 growing degree days. That's when they start migrating in. And the migration continues for a really long period of time, up to 6 weeks post-bloom. At least in apples, that migration peaks right around 14 days after bloom. And then the females, they feed for a while, then they mate, and it takes them a while to mature up their eggs before they start laying them. About 2 months after they start laying eggs, you get another generation of plum curculio, which can be a significant problem in apples and late peaches. Early apples grow fast enough that the developing fruit actually crushes the larva, but it results in these very misshapen fruits. And this is part of the problem in my apple picture that I shared at the very beginning of this presentation. In peaches, peaches don't grow quite as fast as apples, and that peach will actually stop growing, and then it will eventually drop off the tree, and the larvae completes its development. So one thing that you can look for with the fruit, one is in peaches, you get these oozing sapping wounds. And in, I think this might actually be a plum. You get these feeding scars that are very characteristic for plum curculio, these crescent shaped scars. This is actually where the female's laid an egg, and then she'll try to cut these slits in to keep that fruit from crushing that egg. There's a few different ways to monitor for this one. You can examine fruit, or you can beat branches to see if there's plum curculio there. They will easily drop. So if you spread out a white sheet and just watch that sheet, you'll find them pretty easily. There are pheromone traps available for this pest. They are most effective prior to fruit set. Once the trees set fruit, the attractive smell coming off of that developing fruit is just far more attractive than our pheromones. But as I said before, these things come in from the edge. So if you put pheromone baits on an edge tree, then you can monitor that tree on the very edge of an orchard or a planting. And that can really save some time scouting. If you monitor an edge tree, you'll want to be looking for one egg scar per 25 fruit, 2 to 3 times a week. And that is the threshold for triggering a spray. This is also a pest that we can get by with perimeter row sprays and alternate row middle sprays. All right, a couple of notes on control. Sanitation is really important, especially in peaches. We don't want that second generation to develop inside the orchard to just reinfest the orchard. In my home garden, I like to wait until around middle of May, early May, to start thinning the peaches. And I can thin them by hand, and I'll select the ones that have been fed on by plum curculio and take those off. That's obviously not necessarily feasible in a larger planting. Insecticides, we've got Ryman. This is a growth regulator. It's very effective on leaf rollers and coddling moth. This does not reduce the initial plum curculio feeding, but it does cause sterility. So they are not going to be successfully laying eggs. Avant is a fairly specific product to beetles, and it does have some good worm activity, but it's very soft on beneficials. This is a stomach poison. It needs to be ingested. And why that's important is because the neonicotinoids are anti-feeding. So if you're going to use these products together, you want to use Avant first before you use the neonics. The neonics are also extremely toxic on pollinators, so they have to be applied after petal fall or shuck split on peaches. The other advantage to the neonics, as well as the organophosphates, is that they have curative activity. They will kill small larvae that have been laid inside the fruit. So you may want to push those off towards the end of a plum curculio spray program. All right, I've got just another moment or two. I'm going to briefly touch on barren marmorated stink bug. This is another severe pest, a long season pest, but it starts migrating into fruit trees, really with the second generation developing in the summer. We've got two different types of traps that we use to monitor this one. Some of you may have seen my predecessor using these black pyramid traps, and some recent research done out of Tracy Leskey's lab and Ann Nielsen's lab have shown that a good threshold is right around 10 brown marmorated stink bugs per trap, and this is cumulative. So what that means is if on Monday you find two stink bugs in a trap, and on Thursday you find five stink bugs in the trap, you've got 7 cumulative stink bugs. Once you hit 10, that triggers a spray. They're switching to sticky panel traps, which are a lot easier to set up and deploy, especially if you carry vegetable oil. The vegetable oil will neutralize the stickiness if you get it on your fingers. And their threshold is 1 to 4 adults per trap. So that's something to keep in mind for tree fruits. Quick update on spotted lanternfly. The quarantine zone in Delaware has been expanded to include all of Kent County. What this means is if you are moving equipment, personal items, cars, other bits of equipment, or plant material, you will need to go through the compliance checklist, and businesses will need to be permitted to demonstrate that they are monitoring for this pest and to avoid spreading it around. Right now, they're overwintering as eggs. In the spring, right around the end of April, early May, they'll hatch out into these black and white nymphs that are, they kind of look like walking dominoes. And then towards the end of August, that's when the adults come out. And this is what we do not want to spread around, is the adults and the eggs. The adults are not choosy with where they lay eggs. They will lay eggs on anything. One comment from Pennsylvania suggested that adults for some reason really like to lay eggs on burn barrels, which is kind of humorous. But that just highlights the need to be checking vehicles, especially to make sure that we're not transporting eggs around. And you can get training and permitting through Delaware Department of Ag's website. Sorry about that. I didn't realize that I had left an alarm on my phone. But the training is free. The permits are free. And I've included the link right here. The adults will also swarm into plantings in the fall. It's right about when we're harvesting apples. This is also a severe pest on grapevines. Be scouting grapevines weekly. Pennsylvania has been dealing with extreme losses in vineyards. Not only do they basically suck the vine out of its vigor, but then that vine the next year has a higher chance of winter damage. The most effective insecticides for these are pyrethroids and neonicotinoids, not a sale. Malathion, Lorazepam, and Carbaryl. So with that, I'll take any questions.
David, this is Kim Lures. I just wanted to thank you for a really great talk. I learned a lot of really good tips.
Well, thank you.
Yep, and then this is Kathy Demchak here. So that was a raspberry you were showing a picture of with the broad mite issues. Is that correct? I think.
You know, I'd have to go back to Jerry's article. I think these are thornless blackberries, though.
Thornless blackberries. Okay. All righty. Great. Because we've seen them here on blackberries. We hadn't seen them on raspberries yet. So I just wanted to check and see. All right. Well, we'll check on that one. Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm pretty sure that one was thornless blackberries.
Okay. Thanks.
There's a question in the chat about, I had a lot of spotted lantern flies on my vines last fall. Anything I should do or check now?
So what you'll want to be looking for are egg masses and destroying those egg masses. Let me go back to my spotted lantern fly and then slides and then hit the resume share. Let's see here. And share screen. The egg masses basically look like little patches of dry mud. And what you can do is you can take like a credit card or driver's license or a knife and scrape these off. Can you see that?
Yes.
Okay. So this is the egg mass right here underneath of that spotted lantern fly. And they'll have 30 to 60 eggs in there. Then in the springtime, you'll want to be looking for nymphs. There's a couple of different ways we can control nymphs. One is through banding. So you can apply a sticky material like Tanglefoot around the vines. Nymphs like to move up and down, at least on trees. They like to move up and down during the daytime. And so they hit that sticky band and it captures them. Unfortunately, that sticky band is also really good at capturing birds. That's been a big problem in Pennsylvania, especially when giving extension talks to bird watchers about spotted lanternfly control. The other thing that they're dealing with in Pennsylvania is just a radical increase in the amount of insecticides that they've been applying. Used to be that for grapes, we don't really apply a whole lot in season. We wait until later for some other pests, but they've probably increased their insecticide applications 4 or 5-fold just for this one. And where they're heavily infested, they just keep coming in. So good luck and happy hunting.
Yeah, that wasn't very encouraging, I guess. But any other questions for David?
Probably the most encouraging thing about this is they are fairly easy to kill with our registered insecticides. I've seen quite a few pictures from Pennsylvania vineyards of, after one application, just mounds and mounds of dead lantern flies. And that's always a nice thing to see.